Good day, everyone. Once again, you are welcome to Campus Tutorial TV. I am by name Isa Muhammad Lawan. Now, we are going to be treating the contribution of the founding fathers of sociology. One of the founding fathers of sociology. I'm not going to start from the man who coined the term sociology. I'm going to start from another founding father known as Carl Emil Maximilian Weber. The word is actually spelled Weber, but it is pronounced Weber, V, because it's the German word. Max Weber was born in the year 1864 in the Prussia province, which is currently Germany today. He went to the University of Heidelberg at the age of 18. 3 years later, he left for military training. He returned to the University of Berlin, where he earned his PhD in law. Apart from being a lawyer, he's an historian, an economist, and also a sociologist. He has penned so many essays and theses. He died in the year 1920. One of his contributions to the discipline of sociology, he talked about social action. But before that, let me give his definition of sociology. He defines sociology as the science which concerns itself with interpreting understanding of social action, and thereby with causal explanation of causes and consequences. Having defined sociology according to Max Weber, the next thing will now go to his contribution to sociology. The first thing is social action, just the way it is mentioned in his definition. Max Weber is much concerned about the way people behave. He tried to understand the social forces or the motive behind the behavior of an individual. To Max Weber, he said social action is that action carried out by an individual to which a person attaches meaning to. In other words, he said it's any behavior or any action by an individual that take account of the behavior of others. So he divides social action into four. The first one is emotional or affectual action, value-oriented action, legal action, and traditional action. Emotional or affectual action is that action that emanates from the actor's state, emotional state of mind. For example, anybody that is undergoing verbal, physical, or emotional abuse might tend to behave in a particular way. The second one is value-oriented action. This is an action that you take out in order to achieve a particular goal. It is an action that is determined by the concern in the value of its own sake. For example, if you are in school, burning candle day and night because you want to come out in flying colors. The next one is the legal action. This is an action carried out by an individual based on laid down rules and regulations of the land. The final one is legal action. This is the action that an individual takes based on the custom and tradition of the land. So most of the rulers, traditional rulers, such action. Next contribution of Max Weber to the discipline of sociology is the structure of authority is interested in how authority is being structured in society, and he divides it into three. The first one is the legal authority, the traditional authority, and the charismatic authority. The legal authority emanates from the laid down rules and regulation. The traditional authority is that authority that stems from the custom and tradition. And the third one is the charismatic authority, which emanates from human beings' personal qualities. For example, the imams and the pastors, they exercise such authority. When they give order, when they make decision, it stands. From then, we'll move to another contribution of Max Weber. Max Weber, he talked about ideal type. The concept of ideal type or bureaucracy. In the concept of ideal type, he used this to try to explain how things ought to be done in a normal society. And for him, he believes that in a normal society, he identified four elements of a bureaucratic society. The first one, he said there should be division of labor. When there is division of labor, every individual would specialize in a particular field, and he will be provided with an enable environment to actualize his or her goals. The next one is that an individual should be employed based on qualification. The third one, he said, administrative activities should be recorded. And number four, he said that officials and individuals in the society should behave themselves for the collective goal of the society. To him, he believed that a society that is structured along this line, any child that is born within this structured society will have no choice but to live within it, to the extent that that child will not even imagine if there is an alternative to such society. Max Weber believes that when a society is structured in this way, every individual will contribute to the functioning of the social system. The next contribution is Protestant ethics and the spirit of capitalism. This is one of the major work in his contribution to sociology, is the Protestant ethics and the spirit of capitalism. In this work, he tries to merge sociology of religion and sociology of economy. He tried to explain the value, the belief, the value rationale of the Protestants that gave rise to capitalism in Europe. The Protestants, they believe that once you are doing business, your hard work and your business, you are prospering in business, is a sign of calling by God. So those who are prosper, they believe that they have been chosen by God. So they encourage people. People begin to work hard. When you save money, you reinvest the money in order to get a return. They do not encourage you to live a leisure, to enjoy what you work for. The profit that you reap from your investment, you are not to enjoy it for any earthly or worldly pleasure, you are to reinvest it. So now, what Protestant ethics is trying to say? He said the Protestant, their ethics encourages hard work and avoidance of earthly pleasure. And that is what gave rise, according to Max Weber, that's what gave rise to capitalism that we see today. In the last contribution that I would want to take, though there are many, but we can't take them all, the last contribution that we are going to take now is on methodology. His methodology believes in Verstehen. What is Verstehen? Verstehen is a German word which means understanding. And he said he divided Verstehen into two, the actual Verstehen and the Eklarandes Verstehen. The actual Verstehen means direct observational understanding of a social action. For example, you can simply tell if an individual is angry, is sad, by facial observation. Or similarly, if a woodcutter that is hitting a piece of wood with an axe, you can see maybe he's cutting the wood. That is the first one, direct observational understanding. But the second understanding, which he called Eklarandes understanding, which means explanatory understanding, he said no, that simply facial observation will not lead you to understand the motive behind the action of the actor. For example, the woodcutter that is hitting the wood with an axe, it might be that he is hitting it in order to earn a wage, he's eating it to make firewood or to work off anger. So for him, he said, by you just directly observing person, you cannot interpret the motive behind the actor's action. What you do, you should interact and put yourself in the shoe of the actors. So far, we have been able to look at the historical background of Max Weber, his definition of sociology, and his few contributions to the field of sociology. For example, if you are asked to briefly discuss the contribution or contributions of Max Weber to the discipline of sociology, the first thing that you will do, make sure you give the period of his existence, his background, because most of them, apart from sociology, they have other fields that they specialize in. You give the brief, just in brief, you give it. Then you now give his definition of sociology before you now pick the contribution one after the other, as many as you can.